U.S. Treasuries enter oversold territory. The dollar leans overbought and, well, a potential rethink by Jay Powell about the pace of rate cuts. Live from Studio 2 here at Bloomberg headquarters in New York, I'm Romain Boston.
And I'm Alex Steele. Were you waiting for Powell to go a little dovish? Because you didn't get it.
I didn't know what to make of that.
And neither did the markets. They were clearly not prepped for that two-year yield breaking 5% at one point. We're back down from that level. Let's get a quick check-in here on the market. So the S&P up by about 0.2%. It didn't look as pretty earlier in the session, but now we're in positive territory. One of the big laggards here overall in the market is Bank of America. That stock down 3%. We haven't seen this kind of decline for the stock since March of 2023 during the SVB crisis, and its charge-offs were the real question mark. We'll get to that later on in the hour. And this is the culprit. This is the Jay Powell culprit here, almost touching 5%. We hit that level, came back down, but that is really the turning point there for other asset classes in the VIX. By about 17, we're kind of off the highs, but nonetheless, watching all that volatility remain.
Yeah, a lot of volatility across all of the asset classes today, with the big question on everyone's mind right now is whether the stock sell-off is indeed over. Fed Chair Jay Powell just moments ago throwing cold water on the rate cut narrative, and that is helping to extend what is shaping up to be a potential three-day slump in global equities. While some price action today does show an attempt at a rally, you're seeing decent bids into Nvidia, Microsoft, and Netflix. The buyers are just too few in number to really move the needle. Right around now, we're seeing about 300 S&P stocks in the red, with the biggest drags coming from Apple, Tesla, and Bank of America. Rate-sensitive stocks like real estate companies, CBRE, and American Tower pulling back as a group right now for a third straight day. Energy stocks lower for a fourth session, and utilities right now sliding for a fifth. The market doldrums not limited to the U.S. either. The stocks Europe 600 fell 1.5% for its biggest one-day decline going back to July. The MSCI Asia Pacific Index down 2%. That's the most since August. And China's mixed economic growth figures, that's pushing EM shares lower, with the MSCI Emerging Market Index now erasing all of its gains for 2024. Now, some of this is tied to the Middle East tensions. Some of this is tied to Jay Powell and the Fed. But a big part of this move is actually, well, on the back of the U.S. dollar, the greenback strengthening for a fifth straight day, trouncing all of its G10 peers, Alex, and every single EM currency of significance.
Yeah, it's getting pretty brutal there for the FX market. And this kind of shows what Romain was just talking about. This is the Bloomberg Dollar Index, BBDXY. And you can see on a five-day percentage change, we haven't seen this kind of move since all the way back in February of 2023. Just the continued strength day after day in the dollar. And you're looking at, what, 155, 154 for dollar-yen? You're also looking at intervention in certain emerging markets, like South Korea pushing back on some of the moves, in Indonesia intervening overnight. It's creating a lot of turmoil. Even Mohamed Alarian earlier today, Romain, said that authorities are a little bit frozen around the world as to how do you react to generalized dollar strengthening, a.k.a. higher interest rates here in the U.S.
Yeah, absolutely here. And then, of course, you get those comments that we got out of Jay Powell just a little while ago, and it's really causing a lot of agita. Here's what Jay Powell had to say about the path of interest rate cuts.
So we've said at the FOMC that we'll need greater confidence that inflation is moving sustainably toward 2%. Before it would be appropriate to ease policy. You know, we took that cautious approach and sought that greater confidence so as not to overreact to the string of low inflation readings that we had in the second half of last year.
And Jay Powell speaking a little bit earlier at a conference there with Tiff Macklin. Gargi Chowdhury joining us right now. She's BlackRock's Chief Investment and Portfolio Strategist for the Americas. To help kick us off to the close, and Gargi, we had this all mapped out, everything we were going to ask you, and then Jay Powell entered the room and really upended things. Were you surprised by what he said, particularly against the backdrop of all the other commentary we've heard from Fed speakers over the past few weeks, basically saying, slow down just a little bit here?
Romain and Alex, it's so great to be here. Thank you for having me. So for the one thing I would say is that there was a little bit of comedy, a little bit of relief in that Powell and Tiff Macklem commentary, all the comments and comedians being imported. So that provided a little bit of relief to those of us watching the markets. Obviously, it's been a tough few days for both the equities and the bond market. What I thought was interesting was that he wasn't any more hawkish or dovish than I think what we were expecting in the markets. I don't think there was any new ground broken. He could have been more. He wasn't. I think he repeated a message that we've heard before, which is one of data dependence. I do think, however, that the market in its pricing of interest rate cuts being pushed out to further in the year is quite accurate. I think at this juncture, we just don't have the sustained deceleration in inflation for them to even consider going in June. And I think that's exactly what Chair Powell told us a couple of an hour or so ago, in not so many words, that they're going to remain data dependent and that they are still seeking that confidence that inflation is coming down in a sustainable fashion.
So if we sort of buy into that idea, and then it appears, Gargi, a big portion of this market is in your camp right now here, what does the positioning look like? But because I felt like coming into this year, we had a narrative that was pretty clear and the price action seemed to follow it. That has to change now, doesn't it?
Yeah, that has to change, and I would argue that it's begun changing already. So coming into this year, you had that 3 or so months of decelerating inflation. And, you know, as we approach this year, what we have got on the good side is that the strength in just the economy has been incredible. So whether we look at retail sales, whether we look at ISM, whether we look at the labor market, all of that is very, very solid, which is great news for the market. And the stock market has, up until a few days ago, responded to that. But on the flip side, we've also had oil prices on the back of geopolitical tensions coming back up. We've had on very sticky, I would say, services inflation, as well as, you know, that really important component, which is core services ex housing, which has obviously been one that we've all focused on, and all of that remaining as sticky as they have been, makes it very hard for the Fed to actually gain confidence mm-hmm. in the path of deceleration. I think what that means is those of you that are, you know, sort of remaining in the front end of fixed income markets, which has sort of been our call, are still finding a wonderful opportunity to clip keep a coupon in sort of that 1 to 3 year, 1 to 5 year part of the curve. I think that still makes sense, but anything longer than that is being called into question.
You know, I just want to point out, guys, that we do import comedy from Canada. The two Ryans, Ryan Gosling, Ryan Reynolds, like, come on, Deadpool and Ken, like, we're good. Gargi, all jokes aside, what are the inflation catch-up assets that you think that we can be playing here based on the scenario that you just laid out?
Absolutely. So one of the things that we highlighted in our spring investment outlook that just came out a few weeks ago was around looking at inflation-linked bonds. And just the pricing there, again, if you wanted to keep your duration a little bit shorter, I think, you know, front-end inflation, especially out till the five-year part of the curve, makes a lot of sense to us. So specifically in the bond markets, I think looking at inflation-linked bonds, looking at something like an STIP that gives you that 0 to 5 year part of the curve makes a lot of sense for investors. I would say broader, looking outside of that, you know, looking at equity markets, I mean, look, at the end of the day, we have to look at companies in an accelerating environment of inflation. We have to look at companies that have pricing power. What might some of those be? Actually, those are what we call high-quality companies. Mm-hmm. I also think that we need to be a little bit mindful about adding hedges to your portfolio if the geopolitical tensions continue to be with us for some time, which we really hope is not the case. But what can some of those hedges be? It looks like gold has certainly mm-hmm. been an asset that many investors have flocked towards. We look at the open interest in IAU, and we see how much that has increased just in the last 3 days in terms of investors just using that as a trading vehicle to get a little bit of exposure around geopolitical risks.
Absolutely, which is such a great point that you need to hedge on that front. Mm-hmm. For the 10-year, do you see 5% or 3%? What's most likely?
Oh, my goodness. I would say that especially longer out the curve, so, you know, anything away from the five-year point, I think it is reasonable to expect a little bit of term premium come back to the market. I think we saw some of that last year in the fall. I would expect to see some of that return to the market if inflation remains sticky and growth remains strong. I think the longer end of the curve can probably continue to go up in yield. But the shorter end, the belly of the curve, is where you are supposed to earn your income, clip some coupon, go and just sort of earn that income of the fixed income assets.
All right, Gargi, always great to talk to you. Gargi Chowdhury there, helping us kick you off to the close. BlackRock's chief investment and portfolio strategist for the Americas. Coming up, we're going to take a look at some of the big movers on the day, with healthcare being the bright spot in the market. This after UnitedHealth beat profit expectations and affirmed its full-year outlook. Our stock of the hour coming up in just a bit.
Plus, the massive growth potential of AI is now shifting investor focus to the demand for power, where we're going to get that energy to power the industry. Joe Dominguez is CEO of Constellation Energy. He joins us to discuss.
And Live Nation shares leading declines in the S&P on news. The U.S. Justice Department is said to be preparing an antitrust complaint targeted at the company's Ticketmaster business. All that and more coming up in just a sec. This is The Close on Bloomberg.
Last of the big bank earnings rolling out today. Bank of America, Morgan Stanley topping estimates. Bank of America the notching one of its best quarters on record, yet that stock is down over 3%, the worst decline we've seen since March of last year. Joining us now to kick it off is Ken Leon, a director of equity research over at CFRA. That punishment for B of A seems pretty intense. Why?
So Bank of America, across its businesses, we really didn't see everything on firing on all cylinders. What we did see was a decline in net interest income. Loan growth and deposit growth were both flat. We also saw really subpar performances in some of the areas related to investment management. So the area expected to do well was fine, which was investment banking. And I think overall, when you invest in Bank of America, you're looking for the breadth in terms of their consumer banking. And we did see, again, the word flat year-over-year growth. Card income was flat, even though transaction volumes were up 9%. So in my view, there was actually more orange indicators than green for Bank of America, even though the first quarter for all these banks tends to be the strongest seasonal quarter.
So the other sort of thing that came out that made investors not so happy were the charge-offs. They increased about $306 million to about $1.5 billion. Did that worry you at all for its card business?
Not as much, because generally, well, it was really more the lack of revenue, because proportionally, as you have increased volumes, you would get normalized increased provisions, in this case for credit card. But we just didn't see the throughput to revenue, but we did see it for JP Morgan and Citi.
What about the other part of the business here? I mean, we did see a huge uptick in investment banking revenue. That obviously wasn't a Bank of America story. That was a story really for all the major banks. And we saw, of course, some blowout numbers on the trading side. Does that help at all, given the complexion, or I guess the percentage of their business that relies on that?
Well, Roman, I would say that they're way behind the leaders, which is Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley this quarter. Bank of America, they did have equity debt underwriting up 32%. But, M&A was okay. But again, there is a tremendous change we'll be talking about all this year, a new ecosystem between the investment banks and the alt firms, alternative asset managers of BlackRock, KKR, and others that are going to be monetizing. All the underwriting came from corporate sponsors.
Yeah.
We still will get the investments from the alts who have to monetize because they're getting pressure from their limited partners. That's a multi-year opportunity for all these banks. No, but Goldman and Morgan Stanley were way ahead of Bank of America.
Well, let's talk a little bit about Morgan Stanley. I think everyone was expecting a pretty decent quarter. Then we got that news a week ago here about the investigation into its wealth management business. At least for right now, everything still looks good. All of the major businesses seem to do well in the quarter. Ken, do you think that's going to hold up for the rest of the year?
I do. And actually, and by the way, Bank of America, we have a hold, we have a buy rating on Morgan Stanley. We raised our target to 108. We also think, in the case of Morgan Stanley, we got to hear firsthand from Ted Peck, the new CEO, who was tremendous. He talked about how the U.S. economy is benefiting Morgan Stanley more than the rest of the world, kind of asynchronous, where it's 75% of total revenue. in 15 years covering these banks, all these large banks, they're mostly being driven by a strong, not a weak U.S. economy. That will continue. So that's going to raise CEO confidence for corporate raise. And also wealth management was fine. I think it did actually a little bit better than Bank of America today. And of course, now we have to look inside wealth management to where are you getting net inflows. More of it is coming from the alternative investments that they're doing. Goldman was brilliant with the disclosure of this yesterday. Morgan Stanley is right behind them.
All right, Ken, always great to catch up with you. Ken Leon, Director of Equity Research over at CFRA. Morgan Stanley shares, Alex, up about 2% on the day. And I didn't realize this. I was taking a look at this earlier. I didn't realize they're a huge underperformer in terms of their shares based relative to their peer groups in the red on a year-to-date basis. And even Goldman is up. Even Wells Fargo is up. And Morgan Stanley's just been a huge laggard.
That's interesting. Yeah. I wouldn't have thought that, actually, because they don't have that consumer side. So they're not exposed to the sort of the slowdown on the consumer end.
Yeah, maybe some of that had to do with the transition and all of that. We
do know
some of the uncertainty around that.
It's really hard to change CEOs.
Yeah. Yes,
like,
I've heard.
Look at private equity. Look at some of the big banks. Yeah. Doing that successfully is really hard.
Yeah, but the early scorecard on Ted Pick seems to be, okay, this was probably the right pick, pun intended. So we'll see. We'll give them a few more quarters before we start beating up on them.
No, for sure. Yeah. We get a little bit of room there.
All right, coming up here, after a long probe by U.S. officials, the Justice Department may actually be nearing a complaint against Live Nation and its Ticketmaster business. Some analysts say that shouldn't be a surprise. More on that next. This is The Close on Bloomberg. All right, let's get a view from the sell side with our top calls, the big movers on the back of analyst recommendations. And we're going to start with Advanced Micro Devices. The chip maker raised a buy over at HSBC, the price target going up to 225 from 180. Analyst Frank Lee saying there's plenty of demand in the AI market for AMD supplies. And as a competitor to NVIDIA, AMD's next generation AI GPU is up for the challenge. He also adds AMD's non-AI business. It's also showing some improvement there. The shares moving higher by about 2%. Next up, Tyson Foods, flying to the top of the pecking order of protein producers over at Barclays. A double upgrade today to overweight from underweight, with the analyst saying Tyson is in a position to turn its performance around after several challenging quarters. He also says the company's prepared foods lineup is undervalued and should remain a stable segment. A modest bid into Tyson shares on the day, up about 0.2%. And let's take a look at Rivian. An upgrade over there to neutral from sell. This over at UBS, with the analyst setting the price target at 9. Now, this is primarily a valuation call after that 65% plunge in the shares since mid-December. But the analyst says the near-term risk right now is a little bit more balanced, and he expects demand to hold steady despite that broader slowdown that we're seeing in the EV space. Rivian shares getting a nice bid on a down day, up almost 5%. Those are some of our top calls. We do want to pivot to the live entertainment sector and stay in the sell side space. Bloomberg has learned that the Department of Justice here in the U.S. may file an antitrust suit against Live Nation over the way it manages its Ticketmaster unit. Now, the complaint could come as soon as next month. Our next guest, though, says he wouldn't be surprised. Joining us now to talk a little bit more about the possible near and long-term risk is Matthew Harrigan, equity analyst covering communication services and media over at Benchmark. He still has a buy rating on the shares. All right, Matthew, this has to be a long time coming. Obviously, a lot of this got talked about towards the end of 2022 after the whole Taylor Swift debacle here. We knew something was brewing. We knew there was an investigation here. Is this it? Do you actually think we're going to see a formal complaint sometime this year?
I think this is a decent likelihood, and really, Romain, if you analyze the full saga, it actually goes back to 2010 with the initial merger of Live Nation and Ticketmaster, and what they refer to as, vertical combination. I think that the Justice Department and also the head of the FTC, Lina Khan, are very apt to use a vertical theory in looking at mergers right now, and I think that's something that makes them a little more inclined to look at Live Nation. And without casting aspersions on politicians, although honestly I'm not a fan of either candidate this year, I do think there's a little bit of politicization on the timing going into the election. I think both sides are anxious to appeal to young voters, and certainly there's a lot of anger over concert prices. What's interesting is when you look at the premiums in the secondary market, which are triple digits, resale value on tickets. I mean, that isn't really Live Nation. That's some other, you know, companies. The primary tickets are only up about 10%.
Right.
And I think Live Nation has worked very hard to, also work their all-in pricing and take back the surcharges, or at least make it a clean presentation.
They certainly tried here, and I had a chance to sit down with the CEO last year, and he kind of addressed this issue and how they would make changes. Let's assume this suit does come to fruition and they've got to fight this thing here. If the remedy that the Justice Department seeks is an actual separation of Ticketmaster, how much does that change the valuation of a Live Nation business without the Ticketmaster component attached to it?
Well, I think if you look at our $130 price target, about $56 of that is Live Nation. So you're clearly getting not a free play on it in the low 90s, but a really huge discount. And then you'd have to look at the so-called dis-synergies. Maybe they'd be $10 or $12 a share. But I think it's highly, highly unlikely that it actually gets, pulled apart. I mean, this deal was almost, 15 years ago. And frankly, DOJ and Lena Khan have had a number of setbacks in applying that vertical M&A, theory. And obviously, some of it would depend on where the court case arose. But I think if you look at the long line on this, the Supreme Court posture and everything, it's highly, highly unlikely that the company would get taken apart. Mm-hmm. But I mean, this is just a constant, browbeating on the regulatory side because people just don't like high concert prices.
We definitely were all complaining about it earlier in the newsroom. But Matthew, what would be another option? Like, what's a lesser remedy and what would that do to the share price?
Well, I mean, they've had a consent decree. They've been monitored very carefully, since 2010. I think there have been some moderate fines in the context of a relatively large company. Yeah, I think when you look at the scale on a micro basis of everything on the day-to-day transactions, I mean, there's probably going to be a bad actor, someplace. But as you said, I mean, Michael Rapino, he doesn't even have to be a good guy. He just has to be rational in terms of the company doing everything they can to abate that activity. And I think that that's, certainly one of their top priorities. So I think that they're acting entirely in good faith.
All right, Matthew, thanks a lot. We're going to leave it there. Thank you very much, Matthew Harrigan, at Benchmark joining us. But you have to wonder the regulatory overhang in terms of the presidential campaign. Like sometimes you talk to some M&A bankers and they're like, companies want to get in the queue now because it's going to take so long to get through any regulatory process. Get in the queue now, or do you wait until, say, after the election? It's the same kind of idea.
Yeah, I've been hearing a lot of people basically saying it's going to be wait and see, because even if you get in the queue now, you're basically fighting, right? The idea is that can you close that deal before the new administration takes place, the old administration stays in place here. And I don't think a lot of people think they can do that.
No, or they're going to be first up to get through the queue once that happens.
Yeah,
so
maybe
it's sort of like you're rolling the dice either way. And an interesting point on sort of the election overhang for that. All right, coming up, it is the third best performing stock within the S&P this year, Constellation Energy. We'll be speaking to the CEO and President Joe Dominguez coming up next. This is The Close on Bloomberg.
About 3:30 p.m. here in New York. This is the countdown to the close. I'm Romain Bostic.
And I'm Alex Thiel. So earlier in the day, I was at the Intercontinental Hotel for a Bloomberg NEF Summit, and that's basically new energy finance. So how you get from here to there, where we are today in the energy field, and then where we're going to be in the next 30 years. And it was really interesting. And guess what the main topic was?
Nuclear.
It could be, but how you power data centers.
Data center. Oh,
data
my God.
Centers.
This is
the AI thing. How you power them, and the demand growth is crazy. So David Crane works for the Department the Department of Energy, and he was saying that we're looking at 5-6% demand growth each year. Right? Doesn't sound like a lot, but that's a lot.
Can we handle that?
No, we cannot handle that. And that is why maybe we need nuclear energy. Constellation Energy is one of those companies that is talking to tech companies dealing with the issue of data centers and AI. That stock is up about 60% year to date. It is the third best performing stock within the S&P behind Supermicro and Nvidia. You would not have expected a nuclear company to do that for the S&P. So joining us now is Joe Dominguez, President and CEO of Constellation Energy. Joe, such a pleasure. When I kind of saw the first quarter close out, and I was like, you're the best performing stock. We need to get you on. How many AI, how many big tech companies are calling you right now? What's your relationship with them?
Well, the answer is all of them. I think everybody's looking for power now. You both talked about. It was interesting, Alex. You said to Romain, guess what the topic was? And he said nuclear, and you said no AI. And it turns out the answer to both questions is, or both are the answer to the same question.
Yes.
People are looking at nuclear because AI demands a lot of power, and it demands 24/7 power. So that's exactly what we do.
So I've been covering commodities for like 17 years. And in the beginning, everyone was talking about uranium because we love nuclear. And then we stopped talking about nuclear for a long time. And now we're talking about it again. What kind of support do you have from the government with nuclear now? Like, why is this time going to be different in terms of nuclear expansion?
Well, look, I think it's the realization that as good as renewables have been and as important as storage and other technologies like that could be in terms of firming them up, we need baseload power in this country. We need power that runs 24/7 for American families and businesses. And we don't just need power when the wind is blowing or when the sun is out. So the reality is we're going to need reliable power. We've seen that in different parts of the country, Texas, California, New England, even PJM a couple winters ago, which is this large swath of states in the middle of the country. We nearly lose the system on Christmas Eve because we don't have enough reliable power. Nuclear has saved the day each and every time, and it is also the key for the sustainability movement. So it was a recognition that was long deserved, and it took long to come, but it's finally here, and people recognize it from a policymaker perspective, both sides of the aisle, and of course from a market perspective, and that's what we're talking about.
How quickly can we sort of get up to speed on this, Joe? I know these projects take quite a long time to build.
Yeah, so let's kind of talk about it in pieces. I think there are really four things we're talking about when we're talking about nuclear. One is, it wasn't so long ago, and Alex made this point, that we were retiring nuclear plants. Now, we've arrested that with the IRA, but we need to get license renewal. If we don't do that, all the renewables we've built to date, all of that progress will be gone overnight. So number one, how do we continue to invest the capital in these machines to keep them operating for another 20 years? We think we could do that and run through 2060. Number two, how do we increase the output of these machines through what we call uprates in the business? And we think there are thousands of megawatts that are available to do that. That's going to be the newest new megawatt that is in the market. Third, can we continue to do what the DOE announced a few weeks ago and restarting some of the plants that were shut down? Palisades is an example of that. And then finally, how do we bring in new technologies, new small modular reactors? And my personal view is that those things are best located where there are existing nuclear plants, because that's where they're going to be accepted by the community. That's where we have security in the infrastructure to make them run most efficiently. In terms of when that could be done, Canada thinks it could be done sooner than the end of this decade. Mm-hmm. I think the U.S. is going to lag slightly behind, but we'll be there.
That sounds expensive, Joe. Like, who in essence is going to be paying for all of this?
Yeah, great question. And maybe the answer is the same thing we started out with. The AI companies are going to need enormous amounts of power. Now, we have available power today. We're not in a supply and demand pinch in a lot of parts of the country. So the first data centers, if you will be located where we have excess supply. But as we think about building out more of that technology infrastructure, and we're going to need it, the U.S. is not going to be behind on AI. It shouldn't be from an economic standpoint or from a national security perspective. Then it's going to be part of the responsibility of these companies to support the next generation of clean, firm energy. And they're already doing that.
That sounds like tech is going to pay for it, Joe. Is that what you're saying? You're like, you guys want it, you guys pay for it.
Well, I think that's part of it, right? I mean, that's been a part of it, but I think it's bigger than just tech. I think we need to make sure that policy supports it and that we don't have a situation that we had, frankly, when we were shutting down the plants, where we kind of thought about the energy transition with really a perspective on two resources, wind and solar. We need to broaden our thinking. Nuclear needs to be a part of that. Natural gas with sequestration needs to be a part of it. Look, we need firm, reliable power as much as we need clean power. Our families aren't going to care about the energy transition if bills aren't affordable and if the power doesn't turn on when they throw the switch.
Yeah, that's definitely well said, Joe. Before we let you go, There was a thesis like a couple weeks ago when I was at an energy conference, and it was like, oh, all these big tech companies are going to be their own mini power stations. They're going to have their own little nuclear reactor next to their data center, and they become self-contained. Is that going to be true or not?
I think it's going to be partially true. It's okay. Not going to be the answer to every application, but there is already co-location of data centers with nuclear facilities that have been built. We've done it at certain plants on the fossil side of it, and I think it's going to make sense because a lot of what we're talking about is the wires and the integration costs. To do that most inexpensively, we could co-locate these facilities on land adjacent to the plants, and we could provide lots of power to them at the most affordable cost to our customer and to the grid.
All right, Joe, great to catch up with you. Joe Dominguez there, president and CEO of Constellation Energy. We want to pivot from that story to a big story unfolding in the Middle East. Several inches of rain falling over the United Arab Emirates, prompting flight cancellations at the second busiest airport in the world, school shutdowns and traffic at a standstill. Some amazing flooding conditions there. Bonnie Quinn has had a front row seat to it. We go out to her in Dubai for an update on what's happening. Bonnie.
Well, Romain, as you can see right behind me, this is part of the DIFC complex within Dubai, which is its own self-regulated complex of financial institutions. We're talking about more than 50 hedge funds, more than 200 banks based here, more than 100 insurance companies and 350 wealth managers. All told, more than 41,000 people work here on a daily basis. That was impacted, as you can see today. Dubai is not a walking city. It is very much a city that runs on taxis, Ubers, and driving, public transportation, fairly limited in Dubai. Within a few hours of this rain starting, you can see what happened. Cars were abandoned everywhere. I'm looking down from the 34th floor of a hotel room. Cars are abandoned outside right now. The cars that are managing to make it through are being guided through by emergency vehicles, and it really is a sight to see. Dubai every now and then gets these large rainfalls. However, infrastructurally, it's not quite able to manage them. It doesn't have the drainage, although it needs the rainfall for extra water security.
All right, Bonnie Quinn out there in Dubai here. Some stunning pictures there. Wow. Coming out of the Middle East here. Those torrential rains engulfed the city, flooding Dubai as well as neighboring countries like Oman. Several reports of deaths as well, something that we'll keep an eye on and bring you any updates as soon as we get them right here on Bloomberg. When we come back after the break, we're going to check in on what's been going on in the U.S. market and some of the big movers of the day, including United Health. Those shares climbing after a big profit beat. It's our stock of the hour, and it's up next. This is The Close on Bloomberg. All right, it's time now for our stock of the hour, a closer look at United Health Group. The share is on the rise today after the insurance company beat profit expectations despite taking a hit from a cyber attack on one of its business units. John Tozzi joining us right now, Bloomberg News healthcare reporter, to talk a little bit more about what's actually driving that profit beat here. There was a lot of concerns about the hack, how that would affect performance. Expectations were low. They came in above those expectations, and some of that might have had to do with more manageable medical expense costs.
Yeah, I think the real story for United Health Group today is that investors and analysts were worried about medical care costs kind of coming in higher than expected, and they didn't. And the trade you see today is people buying on that news. It's just better than expected in terms of medical costs.
Why didn't medical costs come in higher? Because with other insurers, we've seen a different story.
Yeah, well, and we saw that with United last quarter as well. They saw this acceleration of care expenses coming into the end of 2023. The company at the time said that they expected that to be transitory, and they kind of confirmed that today. Now, they're still elevated relative to where they were kind of during and immediately after the COVID emergency period. But what the company is saying is that they're in line with expectations. So they've sort of priced for what they're seeing.
So it's interesting to see some of their peers, at least in the insurance space, also moving higher here on the day. Is that also for the same reason?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're going to see some of the other companies report in the next week or two. But I think, yeah, there's concern across the industry about how much medical costs might affect profits at these insurers. So this is at least sort of one positive data point for, you know, the people who are bullish on insurers. United kind of said, that costs are in line with expectations.
And you trust what United said?
Well, so this is the question that people on the street are asking is, because of the cyber attack that you mentioned, one of the effects of that, and that's been going on since February 21st, one of the effects of that is that the insurance companies are not getting all the claims they normally get in the time they get them. So they're always kind of estimating their costs in the period. That estimation is a little bit muddier, right? Because they don't have the kind of data that they normally would. So some analysts on Wall Street are saying that you kind of really need to wait till the next quarter to see if this story holds up.
Interesting point. All right, John, thanks a lot. Bloomberg's John Tazi joining us there. Do you see this headline, Romain? Red Lobster mulling filing for bankruptcy to fix its balance sheet.
This is interesting, too, because I didn't know Red Lobster was in trouble. But
but do we eat there?
But it gets, a lot of people do, Alex. You know, you don't be a foodie snob just because you're here in, fancy New York City. But, Red Lobster, those cheesy biscuits, come on.
No. Ixnay. All right, but some people clearly eat there. It's just not me and Romain. He's ragging on me, but he does.
Well, apparently not enough if they're considering filing for bankruptcy. No other real details on this just yet, but we'll get you some more details here, whether this is just a strategic move, as the headline says, Alex, to fix its balance sheet. Maybe one day they can win over Alex Steele as a customer.
I do like lobster, though. There is that. All right, we're going to continue to count you down to the closing bell with David Bahnsen, CIO over the Bahnsen Group. You're looking at an S&P pretty much flat. Dow Jones up by 0.4%. The Nasdaq up 0.1%. Volume okay. Feels like an okay trading day. This is the close on Bloomberg.
This is the countdown to the close. Romain Bostic alongside Alex Steele. 10 minutes until we get to the bell. Alex, and another volatile day. Stocks all over the place. Yields higher.
Yeah, it could have been worse, though. I mean, considering we had that two-year breach 5%, it definitely could have been worse.
Yeah.
Energy sector, utilities, one of the worst-performing sectors on the S&P. Obviously, the Russell down 0.2 as the S&P is relatively flat. You are seeing the two-year kind of not hit that 5% right now, but we did breach that level and then back down a little bit. But, I mean, again, I go back to it could have been worse, although the last 2 days weren't great.
Yeah, it could have been worse here, but it gives you an idea here that everything now is flipping. Everyone has to sort of re-rate and rethink what they want to be a part of, particularly given the latest comments that you get out of Jay Powell earlier today. And we had a chance to catch up with Gargi Chaudhary over at BlackRock and actually asked her about market pricing around those Fed rate cuts.
The market in its pricing of interest rate cuts being pushed out to further in the year is quite accurate. I think at this juncture, we just don't have the sustained deceleration in inflation for them to even consider going in June. And I think that's exactly what Chair Powell told us an hour or so ago, in not so many words, that they're going to remain data dependent and that they are still seeking that confidence that inflation is coming down in a sustainable fashion.
All right, for more market analysis to help us get you closer to those closing bells, David Bahnsen joining us, CIO over at the Bahnsen Group. And David, there's been a lot of hay made out of the comments made by Jay Powell earlier today. You already had a market that was pricing in fewer and fewer rate cuts for the year here. Are you in that camp that we're only going to see maybe three, maybe even less than three cuts this year?
At this point, I think you're likely to see three. And as you know, the futures market started off the year pricing in six. But it entered Q2 already down to three. That repricing in the futures market of Fed funds happened all in Q1, and the S&P was up 10%. So we moved from six to three, and we moved from March to June before market turmoil started. What really kind of elevated some of this price volatility was it being pushed out even further than June. And Alex was talking about, the yield getting up to the higher level, I'm not as focused on the two-year at 5% as I am the 10-year. And once the 10-year hit 4.5%, that seems to have been a bit of a trigger. Ultimately, though, I just think markets have known for some time two things. The Fed is going to cut, and the Fed is not going to cut in the spring or even early summer.
How much of an impact does that really have on equity pricing, given the run-up that we had in the first quarter?
From my vantage point as a dividend growth value investor, it has no impact whatsoever. But even when I'm not talking my own book, I think it's utterly immaterial. It's all noise. The problem is not that the Fed goes in June or July or September, three cuts or four cuts. The problem is a 22 times multiple. That's what makes everything so trigger happy in terms of volatility, especially downside volatility, at any kind of repricing or hint of noise. It's just too expensive of a broad market, which makes it more susceptible to these types of sell-offs.
So, David, if we do get a dip, though, what value looks good enough to buy?
Well, energy is actually down today, but it's been performing very well. But energy is one sector that people would have a very hard time finding names that are overvalued. Many in the consumer staples, that's true about as well. Utilities, healthcare, pretty much the things that were not at the top of the list in 23 for sector performance, they're all at much more reasonable valuations. Mm-hmm. So I think it's kind of everything but technology and communication services that has a reasonable multiple. And then within that, there's some that are more reasonable than others.
Do you also have to have sort of an outlook of what assets have inflation catch up? Like if we still have persistent inflation, what assets are going to outperform and go buy them?
The problem with that is I think it moves very quickly, and it's very clear for anyone studying under the hood of the inflation data that it's not an aggregate price level issue right now. You don't have apparel down 7% year over year and auto insurance up 22% year over year when you have broad-based inflation. Broad-based inflation was there in early 22, but right now it's very idiosyncratic. In terms of the general answer, though, pricing power is in consumer staples. Your Pepsis and your Procter Gambles and names like that, they're the ones you want to own when there's inflation, because they're going to hold their pricing power when input prices come down, their margins expand. But I don't believe that we have broad-based inflation. I think we have nuisances that are kind of lingering.
All right. So, David, you said you're a value guy, you're a dividend guy. When you look across the space here, what do you find attractive on an individual stock basis?
Well, look, within the energy sector midstream, it's still amazing to me how wide those yield spreads are. You have very attractive income from more delevered companies than they've been in over a decade. And so when you look at Enterprise Product Partners, Energy Transfer, we use an ETF called UMI that is actively managed. But regardless of how one gets that exposure, midstream energy is not expensive. It's growing its dividends double digits per year and still has a very attractive entry yield. I think that's a wonderful story for a value investor who wants good income. And I mentioned before some of the consumer staples names. I don't think that one can look at Clorox or General Mills and think that they're overvalued. But these are great growers, and these are wonderful names, good quality balance sheets.
For somebody just looking for safety, for somebody looking to avoid some of the crowding that we've been seeing in tech stocks, you got anything for them there, David?
Well, the energy consumer staples are not exactly the things, you know, that technology investors often go to. But the other area, and we've talked about it before, financials seem to be ignored quite a bit. And you look at some of these asset managers, admittedly, Apollo and Blackstone, which are names we've owned forever and done very, very well with, they've definitely come up a lot, but they're not at an unreasonable valuation. And they have tens of billions of dollars of dry powder to put to work still. But a name like Blue Owl that is not really in the same boat of Apollo and Blackstone in terms of size, but a big dividend, fee-based business, and they're investing their clients' capital. It isn't balance sheet capital. And so we really think those asset managers that are fee-based businesses, that's a great place for people that want to stay out of the tech noise and out of trying to get valuation expansion. Multiples cannot expand a lot from here in the most optimistic scenario. And so I think names like that, that you're just getting organic cash flow growth, it's a wonderful investment story.
All right, David, got to leave it there. David Bahnsen, CIO over at the Bahnsen Group, with about 3 minutes until we get to the closing bells, Alex. And he makes a good point here. There's still a valuation concern right now, at least when you look at the broader market.
Yep. Although if you look at super big tech, like the FANGs or the Mag 7, some of them are not at the peaks that we've seen over the last five years.
No.
So they're not as high as they used to be. So there's something to be said for that as well.
Yeah.
Even NVIDIA.
Yeah, really? NVIDIA?
Yeah, even NVIDIA.
All right, well, I got to take a closer look at that because it just gets to this idea here as to where people find that opportunity. Even if you're just looking for growth here, that story has changed a lot here with stocks on the back foot. Stick with us as we take you to the Bell and beyond.
Beyond the Bell, Bloomberg's comprehensive cross-platform coverage of the U.S. market close starts right now.
And right now, we are 2 minutes away from the end of the trading day. Romain Bostic alongside Alex Steele. We're counting you down to the closing bell. You're here to help take us beyond the bell. It's our global simulcast. Scarlett Fu joining us in the TV studio. Carol Masser and Tim Stenovic in the radio booth as we welcome our audiences across all of our Bloomberg platforms and, of course, our partnership with YouTube. Carol, it's hard to really keep up with this market. I was trying to count, and last count I had, yet at least 30 directional changes on the S&P 500. I just stopped counting after 30 here. As of right now, we're in the red, but if you blink, that might push into the green over the next minute and a half.
Yeah, you made me want to once again check out the volatility index, the VIX. Actually, a little bit lower today, so go figure. You know, this is, again, a market that makes us scratch our heads, and it's also a market that makes us rethink how high we can go when you look at the U.S. Treasury curve.
Yeah, no question today all about the move in rates. Still, can't ignore what's happening in the equity market. We did speak to Jimmy Lee over at Wealth Consulting Group. He's the founder and CEO there. And I posed the question to him, okay, we're about 3.8% from all-time highs on the S&P 500. He says, these are the dips that are the opportunities to get into the market. You know, if you buy now, he says, there's a good chance that by the end of the year, you'll be higher.
Guys, the two-year yield hit 5%.
I know. I didn't want to steal it. I didn't want to steal it from Alex. That's like you know.
But you know, it's worth mentioning that the MOVE Index, which measures volatilities in treasuries, is at the high since early January. Yeah. So it's been pretty much a straight shot up over the last couple of days.
What I'm interested in knowing is that what is today, April 16th? What was yesterday, tax day? So if we take a look at the last couple of days, was there tax force selling, and is that why we're seeing more of a calm today? I genuinely have no idea, but is that also part of it? And maybe we do continue to get more of a buy the dip.
All right. Well, those comments by Jay Powell certainly put a pretty strong bid underneath some of the safer haven assets, a bid to the dollar, a bid to gold. That sell-off in treasuries continues, and a mixed day for the U.S. equity markets. The Dow Jones Industrial Average higher on the day, up by about 63 points or about 0.2%. The S&P 500, which oscillated between gains and losses all day long, down 0.2% on the day. The Nasdaq down 0.1%. And Carol, the Russell 2000 down on the day by 0.4%.
All right. As we know, we are in the midst of earnings season. United Airlines just crossing. Let's go to the red sticky, as we like to call it here at Bloomberg. United Airlines first quarter adjusted loss, 15 cents a share. The street was looking for a loss of 57 cents a share. So that certainly looks like a much better number. Looking for the trade now up about 1.2%. The company also double digit and boost in business demand quarter over quarter, saying the demand environment remains strong. Looking at first quarter operating revenue, $12.54 billion. That was better than what the street was expecting of $12.44 billion. Alex.
Yeah, let's just get some information here on some aircraft deliveries. So the company's saying in the short run, they expect a small number of aircraft previously scheduled to enter into service in the second quarter to now be pushed into the third quarter. They say it's going to have minimal impact on the company's capacity plans, but the CEO, Scott Kirby, talking about the fact that their fleet plan is changed on the reality of what manufacturers, a.k.a. Boeing, are able to deliver.
Yeah, he said, we'll use those planes to capitalize on an opportunity that only United has. Profitably grow our mid-continent hubs and expand our highly profitable international network from our best-in-the-industry coastal hubs. The company noting that it converted a portion of Boeing MAX 10 aircraft orders to Boeing MAX 9 from 2025 through 2027.
And worth mentioning as well, United has quantified the cost and the revenue impact from the groundings of those Boeing MAX 9 aircrafts. It's about $200 million. The stock moving slightly higher in after hours trade right now.
Yeah, I was also taking a look at the idea of sort of what the actual yield they get out of, and that continues to rise, showing that they still have some degree of pricing power. And then we also look at like load factor, which is also up back above that 80% threshold after being below that for the past few quarters here. So on the whole, this looks to be pretty solid.
Yeah, the other thing I was going to say is I think sentiment has been a little dour, to say the least, when it comes to United. I mean, the stock's a little changed year to date here in 2024. But having said that, 5% of the float was shorted. So I think there were expectations, especially surrounding that loss number, that maybe things wouldn't be so great. So to see it, yes, reporting a loss of 15 cents a share in the first quarter, that adjusted loss, it was much better than what the street was forecasting, which was a loss of 57 cents a share. So you are seeing maybe some short covering, if you will, but you're seeing United Airlines up more than 4% here in the aftermarket.
And just to continue, though, on the actual planes that they get, they say that they're in letters of intent to lease about 35 new Airbus A321neos, which is also quite interesting. And they're also converting some MAX 10 aircraft orders to MAX 9. So just details about how they're rejiggering their fleet based on what's going on with Boeing.
Yeah, the Airbus A321neos, of course, are the Airbus equivalent of the 737 MAX aircraft. The company also saying due to manufacturing and certification delays from prior years, by the end of 2023, the airline's contractual aircraft commitments for 2024 had increased to 183 narrow-body aircraft. And then also noting that following the 737 MAX 9 grounding and the FAA's announced significant production capacity constraints on Boeing, the company now anticipates 61 narrow-body aircraft and 5 wide-body aircraft to be delivered in 2024.
And worth noting as well, when it comes to the full-year outlook, United says it expects adjusted EPS of $9 to $11 a share. Analysts were looking for $9.43, so certainly the higher end of that full-year forecast is what people are paying attention to. And I mentioned that $200 million impact from the grounding of those Boeing 737 MAX 9s. They say that without that grounding, the company would have reported a quarterly profit for the first quarter.
Yeah, I'd be interesting to see, too, what they have to say about the regulatory reviews. And, of course, we're all sort of awaiting what's going to come out of this hearings on the Boeing whistleblowers and whether that has any blowback at all to the airlines or whether that gets contained to just Boeing.
Yeah, a lot of questions. But when it comes to it, too, right, we care about what they're saying about demand. And they're saying the demand environment remains strong. So some outlook, and we know a lot of people are flying around. So getting some context, certainly, when it relates to the overall economy.
I'm also interested in how much they're having to pay pilots to fly right now. How demand for
pilots. Not to fly, right?
Exactly. And exactly what's happening when it comes to capacity and when it comes to the scheduling changes they've had to make in the wake of those manufacturing challenges that the company has had.
You guys might have mentioned this already, but I wanted to do it again because I find it interesting, is that they see double-digit percentage boost in business demand quarter on quarter. That would be huge, right? Because that's going to be the front of the plane. That's the premium. That's where they're going to make revenue, et cetera.
I thought business travel was done. Everyone just zooms into stuff all the time.
Apparently double-digit percentage boost in business demand quarter on quarter remain.
Yeah, right now, we're just taking a look at those shares. They continue to move higher here, and we should point out that in after-hours trading, three of the five biggest movers right now are in the airline space. Some other earnings crossing the wire right now. This on J.B. Hunt. Those shares slightly lower here after EPS for the most recent quarter came in below estimates, $1.22 a share. The street was looking for $1.53. Operating revenue also a miss, $2.94 billion. The street was looking for roughly about $3.1 billion there.
Yeah, whether it's dedicated contract revenue or the operating revenue, both of those numbers missing. So as a result, J.B. Hunt reporting revenue down for a fifth straight quarter. Although, according to analysts, they do see revenue picking up this quarter in the second quarter, but that's working off a lower base.
No, that's a really good point. And their revenue was expected to show another decline, as you said, Scarlett, the fifth straight quarter of decline. But what's interesting is they talk about low spot rates, competition within the space, the intermodal space, continuing to weigh on the trucking companies. So some of that's certainly playing out in some of the numbers. So, J.B. Hunt shares down about 0.7% here.
Now, how does that square, though, with some of the data we got on retail sales and some of the other goods-related businesses here? I mean, if we're seeing this type of softness in a company like J.B. Hunt, which in theory is transporting a lot of those goods, do we need to brace ourselves for maybe a downside surprise in some of that economic data?
Or is it just lumpy? So are we just learning that, like, this is just kind of lumpy demand and then lumpy inflation? They do talk about operating income, and they see higher professional driver and non-driver wages and benefits and equipment, but then lower rail and truck purchases also. So, again, it's an idea of, like, things are lumpy, whether it's a demand or growth perspective or a price perspective.
Yeah. In the press release, the company's saying that the decline in revenue primarily driven by a 9% decrease in segment gross revenue per load in both intermodal and truckload, 22% fewer loads in integrated capacity solutions, and a modest decline in average trucks and productivity in dedicated contract services.
So that's load declines.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we're talking 9% drop there. And then even on the dedicated contracts, which I thought was interesting to see that go down about 2% here. That seems to go back to the issue here that they're just moving fewer goods. And I guess whether this is specific to J.B. Hunt or to Alex's point, whether it's just kind of that ebb and flow, that lumpiness, if you will, remains to be seen. But we're going to get the other trucking companies next week, so we'll see what happens.
I just want to update you guys on United Airlines. So they see the second quarter adjusted earnings per share for $3.75 to $4.25, just kind of blowing past estimates there, any way you slice it. They also still feel very confident in their full-year adjusted earnings of about $9 to $11. Again, just like blowing past estimates here. Really solid quarter.
Yeah, and American and Delta are saying, thank you, United. American's up about 1.7% in the aftermarket, and same story for Delta. So we're seeing a lift to the overall trade. All right, guys, that's a wrap. Earnings, certainly the airlines, J.B. Hunt, something we'll follow into the Wednesday trade. A wrap, our cross-platform radio, TV, YouTube, Bloomberg Originals, Beyond the Bell. We'll see you again, same time, same place tomorrow.
All right, stick with us here on Bloomberg Television, a deeper dive into those earnings out of United Airlines. That's coming up next on The Close on Bloomberg.
Welcome back to The Close. I'm Scarlett Fu.
And I'm Romain Bostic. Another volatile day in equity markets. Another volatile day cross-asset-wise. We start with the S&P 500, which finished the day down in the red only by about 0.2%. But there was a huge amount of volatility, directional changes amounting to at least 30 different swings above that waterline, ending the day in the red. Similar story for the other major indices, with the Dow Jones Industrial Average, one of the few outliers, a modest gain on the day, up about 0.2%. But the damage is done. A two-year yield that flirted with 5%, a 10-year yield that is finishing out the day up about 6 basis points, and an MSCI Emerging Market Index right now erasing all of its gains for the year. Dollar strength once again, and you see those rate-sensitive sectors really taking it on the chin. That includes energy, that includes utilities, Scarlett, and it also includes real estate.
All right, let's take a look at some individual company movers here. And we'll start with Live Nation, falling the most since July, losing more than 7.5%. This on a report the Department of Justice may sue the company next month and force it to spin off Ticketmaster. The federal government has been investigating Live Nation for years on concern that it has illegally tied its concert promotion business to the Ticketmaster business, violating the terms and agreement, a settlement that allowed the two companies to combine back in 2010. Another big mover here, and in fact the biggest gainer in the Dow Industrials, is United Health, closing up more than 5%. It affirmed its full-year outlook, also on relief that its first quarter revenue and profit beat analyst estimates. And this is, of course, after a big, costly cyber attack that obstructed the flow of data as well as payments across the healthcare industry and really raised concerns that payments would be delayed by quite a bit. We're going to stay with company news here because our top story for this hour is Boeing getting a reprieve, closing up for the first time this month, gaining 1.6%, but its 13% plunge over the previous 11 days reflects the reputational damage from a steady drumbeat of safety problems. Now, a Senate subcommittee is planning a hearing on what it calls Boeing's broken safety culture. The aircraft maker is losing sway in Washington as well, with one lawmaker now refusing to accept campaign donations from Boeing executives. Romain?
All right, we're going to stay on this story here with Boeing and the airline space. And we should point out one of Boeing's biggest customers is United Airlines. And that company did come out with earnings just a few minutes ago. Jess Menton joining us right now, Bloomberg deputy team leader for equities, with a deeper dive into those earnings. Earnings that on the surface, Jess, looks like investors are happy about.
Well, when you're looking at this stock in after-hours trading, so UAL is the ticker symbol on this, up about close to 6%. So if you looked at the one-day implied volatility on this, so SERP is what I like to use for this, so SURP in the terminal, it would have been about 7%. So it's getting close to what traders were anticipating for those swings in either direction. But clearly here, and we're not going to have the earnings call until tomorrow morning, but we know that there is an internal investigation as well as a probe from the FAA. So trying to see exactly how much it was going to cost United when it came to grounding temporarily those MAX 9 jets there. And so right now it looks like from a revenue perspective, it's supposed to take a $2 million hit for that.
So in terms of what investors are looking for on the earnings call, it's really going to be not so much numbers, but any kind of color on federal regulators looking into the grounding of flights. What are you hearing from what the company may actually divulge?
Well, that's a great point, because also they might not be able to comment when it comes to the external investigation, but when it comes to the internal investigations, there potentially could be more color from executives from that end, just because there are a few different dynamics going on there. But then also the other big thing was looking ahead, right? What the second quarter was supposed to look like. We just heard from Delta recently last week with their earnings, and their second quarter guidance was stronger than expected just because of international travel and also obviously people that are tied to corporate travel as well. So when you looked at what their numbers were for the second quarter from a profit perspective with United, that did beat expectations too. So obviously traders want to hear more as far as what that means. But then also, if you looked at what was in the report today when it came to the narrow body, there's actually about 61 new body plans this year. So that was actually better than expected with those results. But that's also down from a prior plan of around 101 jets. Mm-hmm. So obviously, there's still issues there. And yeah, investors are going to want to know more about that, and especially shareholders.
All right, Jess Benton, thank you so much, giving us the latest here on United, which just reported earnings at the top of the hour. Meanwhile, the safety and culture of Boeing, one of its biggest suppliers, will be the main focus of two hearings in Washington tomorrow morning. To make things more complicated for us, they will actually overlap partially, starting within about an hour of each other. Let's get more context now from Bloomberg's Tyler Kendall in D.C. Tyler.
Hey, Scarlett. So as of now, we are not expecting Boeing CEO David Calhoun to appear on Capitol Hill for these hearings, despite being asked to by two separate committees who are investigating these mishaps at Boeing. Now, I did have the chance to speak with the chair of the Senate Homeland Security panel that is leading one of these investigations. That's Senator Richard Blumenthal. He's a Democrat from Connecticut. He tells me that Boeing is fully cooperating with these investigations and that they are planning to bring Calhoun to the Hill, hopefully later this year. It's important to note that Calhoun actually did pay lawmakers a visit back in January after that 737 MAX 9 door plug blowout. He met with lawmakers in private, but many senators say they need to hear from Calhoun again in a more public arena. That includes Senator Josh Hawley. He's a Republican from Missouri. I caught up with him on the Hill earlier today. Take a listen to what he told me.
What is going on at Boeing? What are they doing to prioritize safety? Why have these planes been in the air? I think there's a lot of questions here, and clearly the public safety has been severely compromised. So I think he needs to answer for what he's done.
Hawley will be participating in one of these hearings on Capitol Hill tomorrow. There are two. The first is before the Senate Commerce Committee. It will feature some safety aviation experts. After an FAA report raised some questions about Boeing's safety and reporting culture, the second hearing will be before Blumenthal's panel. It will feature a Boeing whistleblower, a longtime engineer who alleges that Boeing took some shortcuts in the manufacturing of some of its biggest airlines, including the 787, Dreamliner, Romaine, and Scarlett. Boeing denies those claims.
Is Boeing going to have a presence at either one of these hearings? Are we expecting to see the CEO or anyone else there?
As of now, David Calhoun is not expected to appear. However, Senator Blumenthal told me that they are fully cooperating with this investigation and that he will likely come later this year. We also know that many of these lawmakers are going to ask for some of the airlines to appear, too, and to talk about how they are also ensuring public safety in terms of these aircrafts.
All right. Tyler Kendall out in Washington, D.C. She'll be covering those two hearings for us tomorrow when they get underway. We do want to go back, though, to the general business of travel. When you dive into those United Airlines earnings, they actually were pretty good. And they did show that at least for the second quarter, they expect that trend in travel to continue on the upswing. Eric Rosen joining us right now. He's the director of travel content at The Point Sky. And Eric, we sort of looked through these earnings to kind of get a read on consumer spending, a read on whether we are still buying tickets and going places. And at least for right now, that appears to be the case. Are you seeing the same thing?
Yes, from what we understand and when we look at the markets and stuff, we see that people are continuing to be bullish on travel. Everybody wants to get that summer trip to Europe, especially with the Paris Olympics happening this summer. So we see the demand is still there. As you mentioned, some of these earning reports, the takeaway for consumers is that there might not be as many planes in the air as airlines expected, so the supply might not be there as much. The good news for travelers is that prices aren't as volatile as they have been in the past 2 years. So chances are you won't see airfares spike from $200 to $600 for that trip you've been waiting to book, which is good news.
Well, but aren't prices also still somewhat elevated, Eric, or is that just a mirage?
Prices are a little bit elevated. They're actually a little bit down year over year, depending on the route and whether we're talking about domestically versus internationally. I won't even say this with a straight face, but with inflation adjusted into the prices, they're actually down slightly. But of course, inflation just means it's more expensive for the everyday consumer anyway. Yeah. That said, we're not seeing crazy sky high prices this summer, which many of us feared given what everything's going on in Europe in terms of the Olympics and other festivals and stuff like that. Or other international destinations that have been popular, like Japan. So yeah. there isn't the same sticker shock in store for passengers this year.
Yeah, everyone wants to take advantage of the strong dollar right now. Eric, how much can you trust the summer travel schedules that the airlines publish right now, especially those that use Boeing aircraft? I know I booked an Alaska Airlines flight for my son, and I noticed that it was a Boeing 737 MAX that they were going to be using, and now I'm bracing myself for last-minute schedule changes.
Interestingly enough, you know, you might be a little bit anxious to send someone, you know, on a 737 MAX, but keep in mind that these aircraft have all been very thoroughly examined for mechanical issues and things like that. So it should still be very safe to fly them. Airlines have also avoided some of the issues in past years where they've added way too many flights or way too much capacity based on what their fleets and their workforces could handle. They're doing it a little more conservatively this year, so chances are those schedules will stick. As you mentioned, though, some of these aircraft deliveries will impact the final schedules that these airlines put out. Southwest is already reexamining its route network for several months out based on the fact it won't get some of the planes it was expecting. Alaska mm-hmm. might be doing the same. So travelers should just keep an eye on the schedules that they book to make sure they're not changing too much.
Got it. I also want to ask you about the Visa MasterCard settlement on interchange fees. Bloomberg Intelligence published a note saying that card issuers like Chase, for instance, may cut the rewards on their premium cards. And I know that that's your wheelhouse. Or they might hike annual fees to offset the lower fees that they would end up collecting. I know it's too early to really get a definitive read on how that would work out, but in general, from where you sit, how often do these card issuers devalue the points that consumers rely on?
Well, remember, these points programs are some of the main selling points for these issuers and these credit cards, right? So a company like Chase devalues its program at its own peril. It will lose a lot of customers if it makes too many dramatic changes. As you mentioned, it's a little too early to tell exactly what's going to happen as a result of that settlement. It's still subject to approval by courts. But what some of the potential outcomes are that merchants can be charged different fees depending on what the card used is. So a premium card might incur higher fees. And also remember that some of these fees are used to underwrite things like price protection or purchase protection. Mm-hmm. So perhaps they will strip away some of those benefits rather than the value of the points program. Only time will tell, though. We're not prepared to take any specifics and prognosticate on them at this point.
All right, Eric, really helpful. Thank you so much. Eric Rosen of The Points Guy there. And I suspect there will be a harder sell remain on those insurance plans that they sell you when you use your points to get flights.
Yeah, I'm over it, Scarlett. I feel like it's all smoke and mirror. I mean, I felt like years ago these were tangible rewards, and
yes.
Now you can feel them just being pulled back, and then you just wonder, and you didn't ask them, but you know, there's fees associated. It's not
Absolutely.
Like it's not like they're just giving us this for out of their goodness of their heart.
We paid big fees at the end of the year. Well, you got to use up all the points before it gets devalued.
I'm taking Greyhound.
All right. I'd like to see that. Coming up, the top three, where we focus in on the top three movers and shakers at the center of the day's big stories. This is The Close. Greyhound. It's time now for the top three, where we name drop the people driving some of the day's most talked about stories. And first up is Ken Griffin. The hedge fund billionaire's plan to build a new skyscraper on Park Avenue in Midtown Manhattan has taken a big step forward because he and the developers have filed their plans for this 62-story tower with the city of New York.
I'm not sure we need another office tower, but I was trying to think about like where this would go, and there is kind of a vacant lot down there on Park.
A big gaping hole.
Yeah, they tore down something, so I guess maybe this goes there. But it just shows you too, the phenomenal growth of Citadel is just insane,
yes.
Right?
Already have a big presence on Park Avenue.
And on Park Avenue already, and then he's building this gigantic center down in Miami. So I mean, good for him. He's obviously had a lot of success here, and it'll be interesting to see whether this new building blocks the sunlight out for the rest of us. You know, someone else I've been keeping an eye on is Tim Cook. You know him, right? He's a CEO of Apple.
Yeah, I've heard of him.
So he's been over
Tim
in Asia.
Tim
Apple, as he was once referred to, landed in Vietnam, Hanoi on Monday here. An interesting report, not from Tim Cook himself, but from the government, saying that Apple is and Tim Cook have pledged to buy more parts and supplies from Vietnamese suppliers here. And this gets to this broader idea of how they've really been trying to diversify that supply chain away from China. You've seen what they've done with India, and now apparently Vietnam might be a key component of that.
It's not just the supply chain, but also sales, right? Because we've seen how slowing Chinese demand for the iPhone has caused all kinds of ruptures in the sales profile and the stock price as well. Vietnam's prime minister says the government will set up a dedicated working group to support Apple's expansion in the country.
I bet you they will.
They will roll out the red carpet for Apple here. All right, speaking of rolling out the red carpet, the last person I'm watching is Caitlin Clark, because it is official. The Iowa superstar is going pro. She signed a rookie contract with the Indiana Fever in last night's WNBA draft. And the numbers here are phenomenal. Randall Williams of Bloomberg News was saying that in her first year in the pros, she'll make about $76,500 on the court, and by one estimate, $3 million off the court.
So $76,000, that's a day?
That's a year.
Oh. I feel like they should write that for a couple reasons. First of all, I also saw from, I think it was also Randall's reporting, how much ticket prices have gone up already for the following season. I'm sure TV, whatever advertising revenue is also going to go up. Shouldn't she get a cut of that too?
Well, you know, that all has to be worked out with the collective bargaining agreement.
Okay. Well, the next one there, I hope she's at the table, because I think the main reason why a lot of us are going to be watching the WNBA
is
because of her and Angel Reese, but really because of her. All right. Coming up, we're going to focus in on the banks once again here, a discussion about the earnings we got this morning. This is Bloomberg.
More banks are out with their earnings today. Morgan Stanley exceeding expectations, with traders and wealth managers boosting profits by 14%. Meanwhile, Bank of America's net interest income outperformed, marking one of their best first quarters ever. The two stocks closed in different directions, though. As you can see, Bank of America down 3.5%, Morgan Stanley up 2.5%. Joining us now is Allison Williams, Bloomberg Intelligence Senior Banks Analyst. So we now have all six big banks having reported. Allison, if you were to give a grade to the big banks and their earnings report, what would it be?
So I guess if I looked at the overall results, I guess let's call it like a B. So, you know, but maybe my standards are sort of guided by some of the, you know, massive strength that we saw in certain businesses over the last couple of years and the look ahead, right? So like we saw with Bank of America today, net interest income coming in better than expected. It's great that it was up sequentially, but they're keeping their guide steady. And investors are concerned that, you know, these banks are still over-earning a little bit on the net credit income. We definitely saw on the credit front.
When you say over-earning, what, the idea that they, that at some point they're going to have to finally sort of raise those deposit rates?
Well, it's a cyclical business. Yeah. And so, you know, are we at, you know, are we still kind of coming down from the peak? And if you look at one of the measures that we look at is we look at the net interest income or net interest margin minus net charge-offs, and that is coming down.
Right.
And we do see signs of stabilization in that interest income. So slowing, the deposit costs are rising, but at a slowing pace. So still getting bad, but, you know, that sort of second derivative holds a little bit of promise. So we think that's a positive. But on the credit side of things, you know, things are still normalizing. Credit card charge-offs are typically higher in the first quarter, so we saw that.
Right.
Commercial real estate, I would say a little bit mixed. It was disappointing at Bank of America because of some model changes. I think that, you know, gives a little bit of a worry in terms of how conservative things had been, but I think it's more conservative now. And Wells Fargo actually showed some stabilization, so I think that's promising.
All right, Allison Williams at Bloomberg Intelligence. A broad view there of what we learned out of the big bank earnings, which are now in the books. We continue this conversation with Jason Goldberg, senior equity analyst over at Barclays. And Jason, I want to dive a little bit deeper into some of the numbers, specifically when we talk about what we saw at Bank of America, because that seemed to be kind of the outlier to a certain extent. again. I mean, they had a big boost in trading revenue. They had the boost in investment banking fees, but that was like every other bank. It was really on that consumer side where we saw some softness there. Is that specific to Bank of America, or is this something broader that we're going to see trickle in, particularly with some of the regional banks as well when we get them?
You know, certainly on the consumer front, you're seeing loan losses increase, and they've really been rising each of the last six, seven quarters as, you know, we've burned through the stimulus from the pandemic, and you're seeing losses normalize. I think looking out, I think it's important to note, if you kind of look at delinquency trends, you know, we would expect credit card losses to peak, you know, around 2Q, 3Q of this year, and then begin to reverse. So I think importantly, you know, while they're going up, we are seeing positive signs of the delinquency front. On the lending side, you know, loan growth has been kind of soft across the board. You know, the consumer tends to be seasonally soft in Q1 after a strong Q4, and you're seeing that. But the corporate side is also, you know, was fairly weak in the first quarter.
This gets us to the question then, when we start to talk about the guidance that they gave, some gave hard guidance, others kind of gave soft guidance here, Jason. How reliable do you think that's going to be here? Do you think there's enough clarity going forward from the interest rate picture to the economic conditions, et cetera, where you can put some trust in those numbers?
Yeah, you know, listen, I think with respect to credit quality, interestingly, you had several banks release loan loss reserves this quarter. And if you look at their loan loss reserves, they're modeling like 5% unemployment rates, you know, on average, and we're closer to 3.8% in the most recent print. So, you know, we do feel kind of comfortable where reserves are. You know, clearly, you know, the office commercial real estate sector is going to be lumpy. You saw some banks have outside losses in Q4, some banks in Q1, and that will take some time to work its way through. But we do think we're kind of close to the peak in consumer losses. You know, with respect to net interest income, you know, there's been kind of mixed guides, although it's interesting. I think I felt like last year, every single quarter, every bank got it down. You fast forward to the first quarter of this year, we've had three banks guide up in, you know, State Street, Bank of America, and M&T, and the rest of them actually reiterated their guidance. So you've yet to see a bank guide lower there, which is, you know, I think, given where current valuations are, not necessarily a bad thing.
So I want to ask you about expenses, because that, of course, usually reflects compensation, and it'll affect how people get paid going forward. We saw expenses generally increasing both on a year-over-year basis and on a sequential basis, quarter over quarter. What does it tell you about how compensation is looking across these big banks?
Yeah, you know, certainly Q1 tends to be seasonally higher, and you're certainly witnessing that. You know, on top of that, you have seen, you know, pretty strong growth in investment banking fees, you know, up, you know, call it 20-30% both sequentially and year on year. And trading revenues have kind of been, you know, up for some, down modestly for others, but at a very, very strong level. So if you look at kind of, you know, comp as percent of revenues, you know, while comp dollars may be higher as a percentage of revenues, it looks kind of relatively stable year over year.
Okay, got it. We know that more than half of the KRE, the ETF that tracks regional banks, will be reporting earnings this week. Based on how the big banks reported, how do you expect that to color investor expectations for the regional banks' results?
Yeah, no, good question. I mean, one of the things you've seen this quarter is, you know, virtually every single bank has reported lower net interest income, you know, relative to the prior quarter. You know, B of A, which you talked about earlier, was the exception. And if you look, you know, if you think of the biggest banks, call it half or so to of their revenues are, you know, net interest income. For the regionals, it could be anywhere from 2/3 to 75%. So clearly, you know, they'll have more revenue pressure from just lower net interest income as we kind of cycle through the higher funding costs from the backup in interest rates we've seen over the last couple of years. You know, also, I mentioned earlier, you've seen certainly lumpiness in terms of commercial real estate loans and particularly office. You know, if you look at office as plus kind of downtown retail real estate loans as a percentage of total assets, you know, it's 1% of the top 20 banks. It's, you know, 7% of all the other banks. On average. So it's certainly, you know, something to be more mindful of over, you know, the later this week into next, as you have some of the smaller banks report.
But when it comes to the commercial property side and the idea of the pain potentially that awaits us, is that just going to be kind of a slow burn, if you will? Or are we actually going to get to some sort of cliff that investors need to prepare themselves for?
No, this will certainly play out, I think, over the next, you know, several years. You've certainly seen, you know, non-performing assets increase and criticized assets increase, you know, in the commercial real estate sector, particularly office. You know, loan losses have kind of been bouncing around. Banks have kind of been building reserves in anticipation of this. And, you know, it'll be kind of lumpy over the next several years. I think it's certainly manageable, at least in kind of the top 25 banks, which we focus on, you know, certainly manageable in the context of their earnings capacity. But it is something to watch that could create some volatility for some.
All right. Jason Goldberg of Barclays, thank you so much for joining us, giving us a wrap up here of the big banks. And of course, now that the big banks have finished reporting, it feels like we're just gearing up for the rest of the earnings season. You look at the markets, Romain. I don't think that today's closing prices give you any kind of indication of the nervousness that's out there, especially with what Jay Powell said.
Yeah, I think that rattled a lot of folks. I guess the good silver lining, if you will, Scarlett, was you did actually see some people come in and try to buy the dip and bid. It wasn't strong enough to lift the market here. So at least there are some folks in this market that are still seeing the opportunity here. But like you said, I think this really changes the game.
It does perhaps change the game. And the S&P 500, reminder, down a second day, trading below its short-term trend line, the 50-day moving average. Gold continues to move higher, yet another record high. And of course, we are looking at the dollar strengthening too, gaining 1/3 of 1%. I think higher versus 8 of the 10 G10 currencies.
Yeah, it was all 10. And then also all the EM currencies, 5 straight days of this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is The Close on Bloomberg. Canada raising capital gains taxes on businesses and wealthy individuals, all part of an effort to help pay for billions in new spending for affordable housing as well as other initiatives. Let's get more context now from John Ehrlichman of Bloomberg BNN. John, this has been something that the government has had to contend with, the fact that there isn't enough affordable housing. Is this a done deal in terms of the numbers being proposed?
This is the real deal, Scarlett. Now, remember, in the last few weeks, the government of Justin Trudeau has been taking an unusual path on what's a very important fiscal day here in Canada, unveiling the federal budget. They've had a number of announcements in the weeks leading up to this because of this issue of affordability. And as you know, in Canada, home prices are sky high. The story has been further complicated by higher interest rates. And at the end of the day, the government has been on a mission to try to make homes more affordable for all Canadians, including younger Canadians. The challenge for the federal government right now, though, having run large deficits for the past few years, is that their own debt payments have been rising because of higher interest rates. They want to commit to a spending plan here that allows for billions to go towards housing and making life more affordable. But they have to make a trade-off on that if they want to be seen as fiscally responsible. And that's where a change in capital gains taxation comes in. And the way they're doing this is surprising a lot of people in the business community. And a lot of people are asking questions already, Scarlett, about whether that's going to change the story of capital flows into Canada. We're competing with the United States for investment and new money all the time.
Yeah.
And that's going to be the balancing act for this government.
All right, John Ehrlichman, really appreciate you giving us the details on what we know so far about Canada hiking capital gains tax in order to fund affordable housing. John Ehrlichman in Toronto there. Let's talk about what's going on in the U.S. because Joe Biden taking advantage of Donald Trump's absence from the campaign trail. He is visiting Pennsylvania today while Trump is forced to stay in New York for his criminal trial. Pennsylvania expected to be a crucial swing state with economic angst and the contentious U.S. steel deal only complicating the battleground. Joe Matthew, co-host of Bloomberg's Balance of Power, joins us now. Joe, what is the president's pitch right now? He can't talk about Bidenomics because inflation seems to be reaccelerating.
Well, he is talking about Bidenomics, I have to tell you, and proclaiming himself the most union-friendly president in American history with an eye on those union workers, some of whom he'll be meeting with tomorrow, as a matter of fact, not very pleased about this idea of Nippon Steel buying U.S. Steel. And the president hasn't come out forcefully against that, but has tried to say that he supports the workers who oppose that plan. Look, this is an issue. Donald Trump got union rank and file to vote for him in 2020 while Joe Biden won the state of Pennsylvania. He is tied there right now, according to our swing state poll. And there's a lot of wood to chop left between now and the election. But I can tell you there's a reason why he's been to that state more than any other so far in this campaign. And you're right. 4 days a week, Donald Trump will be sitting in a courtroom, likely scowling at a camera, while Joe Biden could be meeting with voters.
What's the sales pitch here, Joe? I mean, what exactly are people going to vote on? What issue are they voting on? Or is this just a matter of the culture wars and the differences between these two men?
Well, you're asking the right question, Romain. When it comes to the economy, it's going to be bottom up, middle out. A lot of the same stuff we heard from Joe Biden in the last election. But based on our polling, it's the border as an issue competing with the economy, which is quite remarkable to see that. And of course, the impact that abortion is going to have as a mobilizing factor for young, specifically young Democratic voters and women. Joe Biden thinks that he's got the wind at his back with that issue.
All right, Joe Matthew there, co-host of Balance of Power, which airs right at the top of the hour after this program. We do want to stay on this topic here. We'll focus on the election, and a lot of corporations are kind of rooting for what they think is going to be beneficial for them. Joining us right now is Bloomberg Intelligence senior litigation analyst Jen Ree here. And over the last quarter century, we've seen this kind of trend here where everyone assumes that when Democrats hold power, you tend to see sort of this pushback on M&A deals. When Republicans are in power, things sort of open up.
Right.
But your analysis says that that trend might actually be broken.
You know, I think it is. And that's right. That has been the trend. Mm. But it hasn't been as big a trend, I think, as some think. Mm. It's on the margins. You know, the really questionable deals maybe under Republican appointed enforcers would get through, and maybe they'd get blocked or sued to block by the Democratic enforcers. But, you know, we're seeing this change with certain Republican politicians that are aligned with Trump that have talked about the current FTC, which some think is the most aggressive in many, many years, and that they approve of the job that the FTC is doing, and they would actually like to see that continue. Mm-hmm. And that suggests, if Trump were to win the election, it suggests that we could see some continuation of this really aggressive kind of interventionist activist policies mm-hmm. of the current antitrust enforcers if he appoints somebody who's aligned with that thought.
But in that analysis, I mean, are you finding that the success rate or maybe the lack of success with some of these cases, is that going to matter? Maybe the antitrust cases.
Oh, with the cases in court,
mean?
You know, I think absolutely. Yeah. We've seen the FTC hasn't had a great record. The Department of Justice so far under Biden has had a pretty good record in terms of the deals that they've challenged in court. The FTC has not. And I think it does matter, right? Because as more of these deals are challenged and go to court and the companies win, more and more companies will be emboldened mm-hmm. to go ahead and go forward. But you know what? It's going to be the big deals because it takes a lot of time and it takes a lot of money, right, to get through that investigation and then to defend litigation. Some of the smaller deals, the smaller companies just may not be able to do that.
Yeah, that's a good point. A lot of lawyers at that.
Yeah.
We do have an example of what antitrust enforcement mm-hmm. looked like during Trump 1.0 from 2017 to 2020. How would you characterize antitrust enforcement during that period?
And you know what? I thought of it as really odd. That odd and kind of unpredictable. I think the FTC was actually quite different from the DOJ. And I talk about both because, you know, they both have enforcement over mergers. They divide up the industries. I think the FTC was much more of what we think of as kind of a traditional Republican-led FTC. Mm-hmm. Sort of followed along the lines of maybe the George W. Bush administration and even the Obama administration, which was quite a lot like the George W. Bush administration. But the Department of Justice really was kind of a wild card. I mean, this was an agency that allowed the T-Mobile Sprint deal that many thought was anti-competitive to go forward with a really tenuous remedy, which I still think hasn't worked yet, but then sued to block AT&T and Time Warner. And also, remember, gave Live Nation a slap on the wrist for violating a consent order, which now has turned into an issue once again.
Yes, exactly, with reports that
the DOJ is
looking into it. How
much about the AT&T thing? Was that actually related to actual fundamental thing? I thought that was just all about Trump's beef with the certain executive.
I think it was, and it shouldn't have been.
Yeah.
Having gone to the trial, my view was that it was, because
okay.
the theory of harm there just wasn't backed up by the evidence. There weren't documents and evidence saying that the companies were going to do what the DOJ said they were going to do.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the Biden administration and what it's done so far.
Right.
The FTC, the DOJ, they have different track records, but when it comes down to it, how punitive are their approaches? I mean, is it just jawboning is enough to you know, quiet things down and keep companies from pursuing mergers, or are they actually taking firm enforcement action that discourages more activity?
I think they're really discouraging activity, and it's something we can't even measure. I believe there are many deals that probably would have been signed and never got signed because they realize they'll never be able to get cleared unless they go through litigation and then win it. They've changed the guidelines. You know, there are internal guidelines that the agencies use to evaluate whether a merger is illegal. They have now issued new guidelines that went into effect at the end of last year that mean many more deals are going to fall into that basket. And as you know, they've sued to challenge many more than in the past. I think last year was something like 10. When I was practicing, I think we'd get about 2. Way back when. So it's really a big uptick.
I mean, how much does, I guess, the warning that we might do something, how much of an effect does that have? Because a lot of people talked about when Lena Khan took over and they sent out all those letters basically saying, hey, we're going to go back and look at all these things. And I know that put a chill on some folks, and then it actually emboldened others saying, okay, let's call her bluff.
Yeah, so those letters that you're talking about saying, hey, we're going to go ahead and we're not going to do anything, we're not going to pursue you, but we're still watching and we could do something anytime. I think those letters had no effect at all, really. After the first few, it was clear that they were just issuing the letters and there was no follow-up. But there have been a lot of deals abandoned, a lot. As soon as they hear the FTC has concerns or we're probably going to sue you, they walk away from the deal instead of following up and going through the litigation. And I think there's been, we don't know the full numbers because not all of this becomes public or is reported by the FTC, but I think that uptick is probably really big in the last 2 or 3 years.
All right, Jen Rhee, the best of Bloomberg Intelligence here. A closer look at, I guess, what the M&A world and more importantly, the antitrust world, Scarlett, would look like under either administration.
Yeah, I know.
November election shakes out.
I know a bunch of arb traders at hedge funds who think of Lena Khan as like, you know, with a bullseye target because she's just getting in their way of doing their job.
But this is also a reminder, too, of why you shouldn't really trade around an election, right? The idea is that, look, at the end of the day, we kind of move in the same direction. I know there's sort of differences in policies and things like that, but at the end of the day, trying to game it, front run it, I should say, is just kind of a losing battle.
Trying to game and trying to front run, I mean, that's most of the market, isn't it?
No. From your lips to God's ears, stick with us here on The Close. We're going to set you up for what to watch tomorrow. This is Bloomberg. As we wrap up a volatile day in U.S. markets, a push ahead to what folks will have their eye on. And we start over in Europe, where leaders there scheduled to meet for a big summit in Brussels.
And of course, on the agenda is more military assistance to Ukraine, including air defense system. But also, they're going to revive the idea of a capital markets union, which is a decade-long idea to remove some national barriers between their different economies.
Yeah, that was actually the original intent of this whole thing. But obviously, the Iran-Israeli situation really changed that. And we're going to have some couple of big testimonies on Congress tomorrow. We're going to start with Boeing. Committee hearings are scheduled, including one with one of those Boeing whistleblowers.
Yeah, there are going to be two separate committees. They'll overlap for a little bit, but a lot of questions about, you know, what the company did to safeguard its processes, its manufacturing processes. We know Congress has called Boeing a broken safety culture.
We also get another hearing on Capitol Hill, this time in front of the Workforce Committee, and this involving the Columbia University president.
Yeah, and of course, this is in response to anti-Semitism charges on the Columbia campus. We know that she wasn't able to attend the previous hearing last year when Harvard, MIT, and Penn's presidents attended, and we saw the resignation thereafter of the Penn and Harvard president.
We also get some economic data, if you will. It's Fed Beige Book anecdotal data, we should point out. That comes at 2 p.m., and we get quite a few earnings as well, including some critical ones. ASML, that's coming before the bell. I'm actually really interested in that, particularly after what we heard out of TSMC just a couple weeks
ago. That's a really good point. And this is really the European market's only way to address semiconductors and the AI play. So what ASML says will be critical, especially when it comes to China, because it has a way in that perhaps the other semiconductor makers don't.
More bank earnings tomorrow morning. U.S. Bancorp and Citizens as the regionals kick things off. And then after the bell, a few interesting companies as well. SL Green I'm interested in, a big read on the property market, but a couple others as well, Scarlett.
Alcoa will be interesting given the sanctions on Russian metals.
Yes.
And CSX, another transport company, after we heard from J.B. Hunt today.
And then we get Discover Financial. I know the whole tie-up with Capital One kind of makes the results themselves moot. But I am curious to hear just about some of the consumer spending trends and whether the economic data is actually being
truthful to us. Whether we're paying our credit card bills.
Yeah, absolutely. That does it for us here in Studio 2. We'll be back tomorrow, but stick around. Balance of Power is coming up next in the U.S. This is Bloomberg.